You're listening to the ESO Network, your station for all things geek.
It's time for the DragonCon Report, a podcast dedicated to help newcomers and veterans prepare for the upcoming annual convention in downtown Atlanta. With interviews, advice, and news from the pros and fans alike, be careful, you never know, you might actually learn something.
Howdy, everyone, and welcome to the seventh episode of the 2021 DragonCon Report, celebrating 35 years of DragonCon. I'm your host, Mike Gordon, and I'm pleased to introduce you to the rest of our station crew, starting, of course, with director Mike Faber.
Can you believe it? We are now just a stone's throw away from DragonCon. I'm amazed. I'm floored how quickly this whole summer has already gone. Mid-July, and DragonCon is less than, 50 days from now. I'm just like, I don't know what to do with myself right now.
It is crazy. It's one of those things where I'm sort of fighting the denial that it's actually going to happen. We also have Darren back with us.
Howdy, everybody. What's up?
Howdy, sir. Now, I think you've said before on the podcast, I just want to be clear, no new costumes for you, correct, this year?
No new costumes for me, no. This year.
Gotcha. Okay.
Not this year.
So not anything that you're, like, racing to prepare for.
I'm too fat to play Vision. and so nothing else really new has come out in the interim for a guy except for Red Guardian. That is way too...
I was going to say Red Guardian.
It is way too intricate to do leather work at this point in the summer. That's not going to happen in Atlanta in the heat of September. No.
We are also very glad to have Jen back with us.
Hello.
How are you, and how is your costume going?
I was going to try and take it easy this year, but now I have 5 costumes and four of them are new.
you've been inspired over the last month?
One of them I've known I was going to make since last year. I just, didn't start it because I didn't have to.
It is the costumer's way.
Yeah. And another one or two other ones, me and a few other people decided to do group costumes, and we decided on those about 6 months ago. And then 2 weeks ago, I decided on the fifth one because I was like, that's kind of easy. So...
That'll probably be the one most with problems.
No, me and the hubs are going to be variants because, that is probably going to be the number one costume at DragonCon.
That is, yeah. Everybody's just going to slap a variant sticker on their back and say, here I am, right?
Yeah, but I got my hands on the TBA symbol for the front of the jacket and then what looks to be close to the accurate letters. And I have a cricket. So I was like, hey, I'll do that.
Oh, I was going to say we could all just put yellow horns on our heads and walk around.
Yeah, seriously.
Oh, I did actually. Yes, last night I ordered a custom 3D printed and painted alligator Loki that I can wear in my pocket.
Of course.
I'm thinking the 10th floor of the Marriott is going
the 10th
to be
floor
the most.
Of the Marriott.
It's going to be the most photographed area of the whole convention.
We're going to need a Loki exterminator up
there. It's going to be insane there. Wow, that was the one that was the easiest to get to because of the elevator, but now it's going to be probably the worst. But anyway, and we also have with us, making a triumphant return to our show, Mary Lou is back.
Yeah. Hey guys. I'm so glad to be back. It's lovely to see you all again.
And we are excited for you. The assistant director of media engagement, and now in a new role as spokesperson. Congratulations.
Thank you. I am backup spokesperson for the lovely Dan Carroll, whom I know you've had on the show several times.
Oh, yeah, we love Dan.
And folks at home, for all of the people that we fired Mary Lou, no, we did not.
No, we just, with my role and picking up some duties as a spokesperson, we just decided ultimately until there was something to say about the event, it was better to say nothing. And well, now there's some stuff to say. So that's exciting, isn't it?
So that's why she's back, folks.
I'm here.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And we've missed you.
That's good. Yes, we have.
I've missed you guys too.
We love Dan, but we are glad to have you here. So
much more pretty on the eyes. Much more pretty.
Oh, thank you.
Later on in the show, we're also going to be chatting with our new friend of the station, Lisa Bunny, is going to be here a little bit later. The main topic is going to be all the crazy news and information that's come out over the last month or so since we recorded last. And there's been two, not one, but two town hall meetings and a newbies meeting and all this stuff that's been announced. All the guest announcements have been crazy. And I know that you guys are so ready to be, so get your drinking, whatever you're using to drink, your beverages ready, your shot glasses ready, because yes, there will be some guest announcements read on this show. So just in a little bit, but before we do all that, I'm going to get rid of some business. We are a proud member of the ESO Network. We have a Tee Public store filled with all kinds of cool designs, including a very cool one for the Dragon Con Report podcast. There's a link for that at the top of the ESO Network page. Of course, the ESO Network also has a Patreon page, and we thank you, patrons, for all your support. Mike, is there anything exciting going on there right now?
Never at all. No.
Of course there is.
Of course there is.
I hear there's a lot of BS going on.
There is some BS. ESOBS. It's the new podcast exclusive for the patrons. Yes, if you subscribe to the ESO Network Patreon, you can get a monthly subscription to ESOBS, where the board of directors of the ESO Network talk all kinds of goofy and fun stuff. And usually they're bored and they're silly. So hence the BS. So it's actually a lot of fun. And for as little as $1 a month, you too can listen to ESOBS and all kinds of other stuff. Our friends over at the Flopcast just did an exclusive episode built for Patreon, doing a comic book review where Superman takes on his greatest enemy, a mockingbird. It's pretty fun in a Flopcast type of way. So you can always check that out. Please check it out.
Yes, we do appreciate all the support that we get, whether you're a patron or, you know, if you're just sharing the links or however you're interacting with us. We love to have you with us. Be sure to check out past episodes at DragonConReport.com. We can also be found on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Whether you're listening to us via Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Google Podcasts, iHeartRadio, Pandora, Amazon Music, or even Audible.com, please rate us and leave us a review.
And you could also listen to us via our website.
Yes.
The DragonConReport.com. We have archives up there dating back to 2013.
Yes. And as I mentioned, be sure to check out all those past episodes. If you would like to give us direct feedback. Exactly. if you would like to leave us direct feedback or comment on our show, please feel free to do so at feedback@DragonConReport.com. So that's all the business out of the way. We're going to get started with some news and notes. Before we get to the guests, I think I've made this announcement already because I think we knew about this, but I just wanted to reiterate this because DragonCon did make it sort of official that the official charity is once again Big Brothers and Big Sisters of Metro Atlanta. DragonCon is going to match 100% of the donations made at the event, up to $100,000. So that is exciting, and it's a good cause. And I think it was the cause that they had last year, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. But of course, you know, with the virtualness of it, and we want to try to get more funds to those kids, right? And that program.
Absolutely. Yep. They're a really great program and something we really want to support. So we've brought Big Brothers, Big Sisters of Atlanta back this year as our charity.
That's very cool. And we will have a link to that in our show notes as well. So before we get started with some other news and talk about the town hall chat, let's go through, because there's been a ton of guest announcements. So let's start in with those. And again, everybody get your drinking containers ready, your beverages ready, your shot glasses, because here we go.
The Atlanta Radio Theater Company. The Atlanta Radio Theater Company has performed live original audio drama at DragonCon since the very beginning.
Raymond Carr is puppeteer and filmmaker who co-stars in the Jim Henson Company series Splash and Bubbles and is an ensemble member of the puppet improv group Puppet Up for Henson Alternative and Earth to Ned on Disney Plus. He is on the board of Film Impact Georgia.
Erin Gray is an American actress best known for her roles as Kate Summers in the situation comedy Silver Spoons and as Colonel Wilma Deering in the science fiction television series Buck Rogers in the 25th Century. For over two decades, Gray has performed in over a dozen feature films.
Our 2021 artist guest of honor, William Stout, is an American fantasy artist and illustrator with a specialization in paleontological art. His paintings have been shown in over 70 exhibitions, including 12 one-man shows. He has worked on over 30 feature films, doing everything from storyboard art to production design.
Emmy Award-winning Rob Paulsen voices some of the most well-known characters of all time, including Yakko Warner and Pinky of Pinky and the Brain on The Animaniacs, Raphael Donatello, the TMNT, Arthur in The Tick, the title role in The Mask, Carl Weezer in Jimmy Neutron, and many more.
Tress MacNeille is an American voice actress best known for providing various voices on the animated series The Simpsons, Futurama, Tiny Toon Adventures, Disney's House of Mouse, Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers, and Dave the Barbarian. She's also Dot Warner of the Animaniacs.
Voted most likely to be someone else by his high school classmates, Maurice LaMarche has been doing character voices and impressions since his childhood. DragonCon fans love him as the Brain on Animaniacs, Pinky and the Brain, and for Futurama, where he does over 70 regular voices.
Now, I'm sensing a theme here. Jess Harnell, named by the entertainment industry Variety's magazine as one of the top 10 voice actors in the business, the Emmy-nominated actor is truly one of the best and busiest. He's perhaps best known as Wacko Warner on The Animaniacs.
Ross Marquand is an American actor that has appeared on film, stage, and television. He is best known for portraying the role of Aaron on The Walking Dead. His voice acting talents can be heard in the likes of Robot Chicken, Family Guy, and American Dad.
Matthew Lewis rose to fame as Neville Longbottom in all 8 Harry Potter films. He went on to star in Wasteland and was in the recent film adaptation of Me Before You. Matthew's TV credits include Bluestone 42, The Syndicate, Ripper Street, and Happy Valley.
Felicia Day is a professional actress who has appeared in numerous shows and films, including Buffy, Eureka, Dr. Horrible's Sing-Along, The Guild, Dragon Age, Supernatural, and many more. She currently stars in the revival of Mystery Science Theater 3000 on Netflix.
Michael Trucco is best known for his role as Samuel Anders in Battlestar Galactica.
Edward James Olmos is well known for his role as Admiral William Adama in Battlestar Galactica.
Mary McDonnell starred as President Laura Roslin in the Sci-Fi Channel's hit series Battlestar Galactica. McDonnell currently stars as Captain Sharon Rader on the TNT hit drama series Major Crimes, the spinoff of the series The Closer, where McDonnell originated the role and earned a Primetime Emmy nomination.
James Callis is a British actor who is best known for playing Dr. Gaius Balter in the reimagined Battlestar Galactica miniseries and television series.
Jamie Bamber is a British actor known most widely for his roles as Lee Adama on Battlestar Galactica and Detective Sergeant Matt Devlin on the ITV series Law & Order UK.
The Brobding...
Let me do it for you. Brobdingnagian bards.
Bards are back, back for a DragonCon reunion. They take traditional Irish and Scottish folk songs, mix it up with Lord of the Rings music to create a unique brand of Celtic filk.
One of the most respected actors of his generation, Zachary Levi, has become known for his captivating on-screen presence. He is known for his roles in the fan favorites Chuck, The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, Tangled, Thor of the Dark World, and as the titular character in the highly anticipated movie Shazam.
Asher Angel began his career as a child actor in the 2008 film Jolene, starring Jessica Chastain. He is known for his role as Jonah Beck in the 2017 Disney Channel series Andy Mack and as Billy Batson alongside Zachary Levi in DC Comics' Shazam.
Jim Cummings has done scores of voices from Winnie the Pooh and Tigger 2 to Darkwing Duck. This includes voiceover work in hundreds of television and radio commercials, movie trailers, promos, and video games.
Chris Bivens has worked on a variety of projects from storyboards on the Velcro Experiment to animation on slot game Dragon's Lair. Along with his partner in crime, Joe Karg, they are the art collective Combo Break and have combined to take the comic book and animation worlds by storm.
Tom Welling is an actor, director, and producer who is best known for playing Clark Kent Superman on the long-running television series Smallville. Welling can recently be seen playing the role of Marcus Pierce in the third season of Lucifer.
Laura Diane Vandervoort is a Canadian actress best known for her roles as Supergirl in the television series Smallville and Sadie Harrison in the television series Instant Star. She also starred as Lisa on the ABC series V.
Michael Rosenbaum has displayed his versatility as an actor by tackling diverse roles. Equally adept at comedy and drama, he has played characters ranging from a transvestite to a crazed fraternity boy to Lex Luthor.
Erica Durance is perhaps best known for her role as Lois Lane on the WB, now the CW, series Smallville. She was a frequent guest star for the fourth season of the show, ranging 2004 to 2005, and joined the regular cast for the fifth season, sixth season, and seventh season.
Best known to fans as the voice of Duke Nukem, John St. John has brought life to countless characters for games, including Dotaz, Guild Wars 2, World of Warcraft, Sonic Adventures, Call of Cthulhu, Half-Life, Star Trek Online, Counter-Strike GO, and more, working with industry leaders and independent developers worldwide.
Grace Rolek is best known for playing Connie on Cartoon Network's hit show Steven Universe. You may have heard her voice as many characters, including Marlene in Final Fantasy VII, Luis in Lou and Lou Safety Patrol, and Lucy Van Pelt in Happiness as a Warm Blanket to Charlie anymore. Brown.
Yeah, people are on the floor already. It's okay.
You're asking us to translate Roman numerals into numbers, so stop it. Mark Pellegrino is an actor of film and television. He is best known for his work as Lucifer in Supernatural, Paul Bennett in Dexter, Jacob in Lost, and as Bishop in Being Human. He also recurred in the role of Clayton Haas in the ABC thriller Quantico.
Jennifer Paz is the voice of Lapis on Steven Universe. She's an award-winning musical stage actor and concerter with Broadway, regional, and international tour credits, including Miss Saigon, Les Miserables, Flower Drum Song, Cinderella, Beauty and the Beast, to name a few.
Dee Dee Magno-Hall is currently the voice of Pearl on Cartoon Network's Emmy-nominated series Steven Universe and Snugs the Hedgehog in Doc McStuffins. Hall's resume boasts an extensive list of credits, including theater performances, TV and film appearances, and voice recordings.
Robert Chapin is a multi-hyphenate actor, writer, director, VFX artist, stuntman, fight choreographer, swordsman, with starring roles in Ring of Steel, Dragon Fury, and The Hunted.
Emily Swallow is best known as the Armorer in Disney Plus's The Mandalorian and as Amara, a.k.a. The Darkness, in Supernatural. She also appears in SEAL Team, The Last of Us Part II, Castlevania, and others.
John Romita Jr. is best known for his extensive work for Marvel Comics from the 1970s to the 2010s, including Spider-Man and X-Men. He also co-created Kick-Ass and Hit-Girl.
Woohoo! You guys get a total thumbs up. Congratulations, guys. Hopefully you guys, there's listeners out there still awake. So,
but there's none out there sober.
No.
I would like everyone to know that this is a cold reading event.
No, of course.
Get the list like while we're recording. Okay, so. Just FYI.
They actually announced today a couple of the musical guests that are going to be at the show. They actually announced that Cybertronic Spree is coming back.
Woo!
So is Jess O'Lantern. Valentine Wolf and Marquis of Vaudeville is going to be at the show. But those are just the beginning. I know there's going to be a lot more. I know our friends, Misbehaving Mavens, I think are rumored to be appearing at Dragon Con, and there's a couple others also. So it should be very interesting to see who we get, but we don't like talking about rumors on the show, of course.
Well, I know that they are, you know, there's big concern from all the purists. They want, it's not a convention unless Voltaire and the Crack Shadows are appearing somewhere, right? So,
well, Mike, you know what I heard?
Do tell, Darren, what did you hear?
That was great. And yeah, they are announcing someone new almost every day now. So, I think in the first town hall meeting that they did, about a month ago, or a few weeks ago anyway, they said there's like 40 announcements to make, and they're still getting more guests that are coming through and being registered. So it's going to be, anybody worried that this year probably wouldn't have a lot of like quote unquote cool celebrities or, you know, fun folks. I think just that list there shows that, Even if it stops there, there's still a lot of great people that are coming to Dragon Con this year.
Or, you know, maybe just broaden your horizons of what you're fans of.
that's true.
It's a big variety so far.
Absolutely. A lot of classic and some new stuff. And yeah, it's some really, I think, great names. And I think, again, it shows, you know, how fortunate we are to be in an area where they happen to be filming a lot, you know, because I don't think it would be as easy to get the two stars of the Shazam movies if we weren't here in Atlanta, right? So, because I know that's being filmed here. But very cool. So thank you guys so much. Appreciate that. And so, yeah, we'll get into all the other announcements. And I think that, you know, as we start with the news and the announcements that were made in the town hall meetings, by the way, Tony and his team that put on those town hall meetings are really well done. They're really fun. They're energetic. If you can listen to them or watch them, certainly if when they're happening, they're great. But they also they record them. So you're able to watch them whenever via Facebook, YouTube, I think some other ways as well. So I would recommend doing that. They're kind of entertaining. Not as entertaining as us, of course. But anyway, a lot of times you could see stuff and hear stuff first there. I mean, they usually like break something exclusively, like break news, you know. And they even tease some stuff that's coming up as well. So good stuff there. But I think... Marianne, I want to ask you about this too, because I think first and foremost, the main thing that people are concerned about is safety. And I know that there's not a lot of definite information about what protocols are going to be in place, but I know that, you know, from listening to everybody that we talked to who's related to the convention, they are taking it very seriously.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Dragon Con leadership is working with all kinds of local health officials, doctors, the CDC, just paying really close attention to updated guidelines. And we're also looking at what other local events are doing. So like other conventions and the Braves and our local soccer team in Metro Atlanta, kind of just looking to those other organizations to see what works, what doesn't, what they're doing, and kind of letting them lead the way. But absolutely, we'll be paying attention to everything right up until the very last minute. But all those official safety measures will be available August 1st. We do know that there will be an attendance cap, and we do expect to sell out before the event. So if you're planning to go to Dragon Con, buy your badge. Buy it now. we don't know what that number is, and I don't know what the attendance cap number will be, but there will be a cap, and we expect to reach it for the con.
I do know that the cap already is configured in a way that includes everybody who's rolled over. So mm-hmm. anybody who has a badge now, mm-hmm. who has pre-purchased a badge for this year, or is rolling over from last year, don't worry, you're not going to get cut off.
Yes.
Those people who are asking about 1-day memberships, I know they announced that 1-day memberships for select days will probably go on sale August 1st, but of course that depends on, you know, whether or not they've reached the cap already. So.
Right. It's all in flux still. You know, there's a lot of moving targets at this point. So, yeah, exactly. I should mention also that Eternal members are included in that number as well.
Of course. And I think it's safe to say too that even though they're making this amazing like number of guest announcements, and some of us are rolling over as guests from last year, I do think that even though it's not been explicitly said, I do think that there's going to be fewer guests this year.
We are expecting a smaller guest list. I don't have any specifics on that, but we are expecting a smaller guest list and a smaller attendee crowd as well.
Sure.
But we are greatly expanding the online virtual content. So people who aren't able to come to the convention or aren't comfortable, there is something online for you too.
Yeah, and some new stuff.
So don't plan on walking up to the con and on Saturday and planning on going and saying, "Hey, I need to get a badge," or something like that. You're not going to do it.
Or or worse, think you have a hotel reservation and that means you're going to get a badge. You need to have your badge separate from that.
Oh, exactly.
ASAP.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. As we talked about in previous episodes, none of the hotels are rolling over. So if you've got a hotel reservation, you're going to be coming, you're going to be using it in some way. So yeah, I hope you have a badge as well, because you're going to need that to participate for sure. And now one thing I saw in the chat, and this sort of speaks to the safety aspects of it, and I want to get the rest of you's thoughts on this too, because I kind of thought it was just kind of this weird attitude, but there seemed to be, from the chats in the room, there were some people who were concerned about, you know, like, hey, I'm not really sure if I feel like going, or hey, I'm not really sure, you know, what protocols are going to be in place, and I'm kind of nervous about going or whatever. The consensus seemed to be, the usual response from other people in the chat room, not officially DragonCon, I want to make that clear, this is not an official DragonCon response, but a lot of the other people that were coming were basically saying, if you're scared, stay home. Which in some ways makes sense, but in other ways struck me as kind of rude.
I think it's more of a matter that just people are really tired of having or seeing the same discussions that we've been having for a year, and so they're quick to snap about it. I mean, especially those of us that like normally have social anxiety, and then this year kind of like made us feel normal, because we're like, ha ha, I don't have to go anywhere.
I don't want to, which is nowhere. Yay.
Yeah. You know, so yeah, things are opening up, and going back to a con is a big step.
Well, I mean, we've said this, but, you know, we've said this on the podcast before. If you feel sick, stay home, and people would still show up and share their germs with everybody in the hotels. This year, stay home. If you're sick, stay home. And if you're not vaccinated, go get your shots ASAP or stay home. That's what I would say, not if you're scared.
Yeah, you're almost getting close to being out of time for the cutoff for your vaccine.
Yeah. Well, I'm thinking, like, you know, regardless of what the mask policy ends up becoming,
it
helped me out so much this year with, like, I didn't catch the flu, and I didn't get like 8 sinus infections.
Well, allergies have been because of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's made. So I'm already prepared to, like,
I've got,
I see a crowd walking towards me.
I've got emergency ready to go to get pumped up before the con. I'm good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes perfect sense. That really does make perfect sense. And yes, I definitely agree about the whole mask thing. And I think that was even mentioned, you know, like, hey, some people might just want to wear masks because, hey, they don't want to get con cred. You know, like, it's not all about COVID, you know?
Yeah, I've come home with con cred 10 out of 11 years, pretty much. So it'd be nice to not have it
again.
When
you feel that little tickle at the back of your throat on Sunday night, you're like, oh.
DragonCon already is something that takes so much out of you. I mean, it's so worth it, but it is such an exhausting, energy draining experience
there's a reason it takes 2 weeks to
recover.
Even if you don't get anything, you're going to need a recovery time, and you put any sort of, you know, germs on that, and you're done for a month. You're down for a month. Now, and I understand people's nervousness as well. I mean, I have opted not to do any conventions before DragonCon, which on the one hand was like, okay, because I'm saving DragonCon, because DragonCon is important to me. So that's the one I'm gearing for to be ready to do. But the other part of me is like, maybe I should have started smaller first. Like, because once I go to DragonCon, even with the limited capacity, it's still going to be huge. Right. I mean, it's like it's jumping into the deep end. Right. Like
our option here, if we want to go to a convention, is in like 3 weeks to go to an outdoor one held at Fiesta Texas Six Flags Park, where you're not just dealing with con attendees, you're dealing with regular park goers.
Ooh, wow.
And then vendors and celebrities, you know, are in like an air conditioned tent. It's like nothing about that, but a Texas 100-degree weather
and a tent. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
at a theme park. Well,
also at Dragon Con, we're still going to have people from the football game there also, because I know those are going on still. They haven't canceled those.
Right. Right.
And so we're going to have football fans from all around the country coming in.
And I would hope that they're vaccinated, but I'm concerned that there might be a significant portion of them that aren't.
It could be.
Just being honest. I'm just concerned about that. So.
Well, I mean, I think we have to assume now, because of the statistics in the country, that a majority of people still aren't.
The state of Georgia is under 40% vaccinated. You know, come on.
So, like Mike said, if you're planning on going, please, like, get vaccinated now, because that therefore you'll be fully vaccinated by the time the convention happens. Mm-hmm. You want to make sure that that happens, and you should be able to arrange that. So we do encourage, we encourage vaccinations here on this podcast. So, all right. So the other stuff that they sort of talked about, and, you know, I know that Mike and Jen, you guys watched the town hall meetings as well. So I'll certainly chime in with any thing that stood out for you. But the first and foremost thing that I noticed that they talked about was new merch, of course, because Tony Light was talking about the new merch. They've got some new 35th anniversary shirts and sleep pants, I think they're called. The pajama bottoms, I don't know what you call it, but they're these.
I ordered it as soon as the
that
time
is awesome,
was over
though.
With.
That
the, shirts
is awesome.
Look, the shirts do look cool.
And their long sleeve shirts have typically been a nice soft material.
They're like three quarter sleeve,
so
aren't they?
Yeah.
I think so. Right up your alley, Mike.
I know. I love it. I'm looking at it as we speak.
Yeah, they're pre-order though, right? They're not really.
Yeah, they said at least as of that town hall, they said if you pre-ordered it then, that the plan was they would have it to you before you even left to go to con. So that you could bring it with you to con if you so desired.
They also hinted that we were going to get another baby dragon.
But they didn't.
Of course. Does it matter?
No, it doesn't.
If they just said pre-orders now, you would be pre-ordering it now. You would already be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they could just show a little
it could
shadow.
Be some 1970s art from D&D. Jen would be like, here's my card. Take it.
No, yeah, it has to go in my pile of other dragons. I have a pile.
You have a horde of dragons now. There's some irony for you, kids.
One thing that I was really very excited to hear about is that I knew we were getting virtual content this year because, well,
we've already done some. Hello.
We've already recorded some. And for those people who plan on be there, don't dismiss the virtual content, because it's not just going to be recording stuff that happens at the convention. Mike and I have recorded several panels that will only be available virtually. You won't be able to, you can't go to those panels because we've already recorded them. So if you want to, not just for our panels, but if you want to experience some more panels, some more events virtually, there's going to be a lot of content that's going to be available that won't be available if you're in person. So I think that's pretty exciting.
Well, plus it sounds like for those of us that are in non-host hotels, and, you know, so we have to, we get our streaming pass just to have DC TV. It sounds like this year we'll be getting more bang for our buck.
Yeah, totally.
With DC TV.
Yeah. And I think the price is still going to be the same. I think it's $10 for the year. I don't think it's American. You confirm that? Is that true? Is it still $10?
It is still $10. Yeah.
Cool. That's a bargain.
It is a bargain for all you get.
Yeah.
And you get streaming all the way until the end of the year, pretty much.
They hinted that the platform may change. Do you know, have any details about that?
Currently, it's streaming through March of next year.
Okay. Mm. Gotcha.
So you'll get it from September.
That's even better. That's amazing. It's worth it for $10. Come on.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And everything. Because, like, the hotel I stay at is right off site. They do get the Dragon Con TV classics, but we don't get the actual Dragon Con TV at the hotel. So it's, you know, so getting the streaming service would be perfect.
Yeah, there are some old panels I would love to go back and see. Like, just depending on how interactive it is. I mean, I know that all that stuff's still in progress, but, like, my first panel I ever went to at Dragon Con was William Shatner 10 years ago. Like, I would love to go back and watch that panel again.
I do believe you can.
for old time's sake, you know?
Yeah.
And then I always love DC TV because there are panels that like I'm interested in, but because of my schedule or whatever, you know, I can't go be in line for it ahead of time. So that's always really fun.
Yeah, I,
and, you know, I'm changing costumes 10 times a day, so something on in the background.
I'm either at my table or at a panel that I'm on, so I don't get to, I haven't got a chance to attend a lot of panels about with anybody really else.
Well, so. I mean, the regular attendees have this problem too, because you always want to see two panels that are happening at the same time.
Exactly. Exactly.
And cloning is not an option yet.
Now,
damn it.
Well, also in the evenings, being able to see the costume contest, you know, through your streaming pass is also like, that's one of my favorite things to do, to like take a break at night before I either decide, am I going back out for parties or am I just staying in? I get to watch.
Okay, let's all assume that Jen takes a long time to make that decision.
They did say that the costume contests, the official Dragon Con costume contest and the Masquerade Ball will be held. So they will be doing both of those. There will not be a costume contest at the Aquarium. There will be an Aquarium event. The VIP tickets are already sold out. But there is a chance to get a couple passes via a contest that they're running. So you can check out more information about that at DragonCon's website or on their Facebook page. You can still come in costume. They are encouraging people that are going to the Aquarium, because you can not only the VIP tickets, but the general admission, which I believe is at 50% now.
Or it was at 50% on July 8th, but they said they were expecting that to possibly sell more right after that town hall.
Good call. So if you're planning on going and checking out the Aquarium, you want to make that decision as quickly as you can, because that might not be an option for you there. Like, it might.
And they did confirm they're bringing the pin back.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Aquarium pin. All VIP guests are guaranteed, or VIP tickets are guaranteed to get one, but for general admission, only the first 2,000 people entering will get one.
Well, now.
pins are huge, man. People like their pins, and I understand they're coming out with a new, have they already debuted it, the new 35th anniversary pin, merchandise-wise? Okay.
I haven't seen
that's
one.
Probably coming. But my point was that, like I said, I knew that there was virtual content going to be provided, original virtual content for that, which I'm very excited about it. But the one thing that, I am super excited about as a, guy who hangs out in the comic book artist alley is that the virtual marketplace for vendors is going to be available as well. So that people can come to the Artist Alley, see me, buy my books, but if they can't get there for some reason, or if they can't even come to the convention for some reason, they can still go to Event Envy and shop the virtual marketplace and get a bunch of stuff there. And they said it was going to be available a few days after the con as well. So, you know, if you walk around, see something, and you're like, oh, but you don't get a chance to go back, or, you know, you're on that Tuesday or Wednesday after con, you're like, man, I wish I'd bought that. You still have opportunities to do so. So that's awesome. The virtual marketplace was really successful for a lot of vendors. For Dragon Con itself last year, way more successful than I think they thought it was going to be. And it was more successful than I thought it was going to be. Like I said, I actually sold more things last year than I did in the in-person event the year before. So so to have that option again, I'm very excited about that. So so we will have links to all of that stuff, of course, as we get closer and closer to the convention, so that people can find the virtual marketplace. Because I know some people last year were like, I couldn't, you know, and I know that at the convention itself, people are always like, I couldn't get there. So now you can be like, send them a link and go, you can go right here and see it online. So that's good news for the vendors and all of that. I think we've talked about this before, Mike. I think you mentioned it, but there's not going to be any fan tables.
No, sadly enough, almost all fan tables have been canceled. There's going to be a few individual ones still out there, But I think the majority of them have been either postponed till next year or just flat out canceled. I know for ESO, we were planning on doing one this year, but that got, you know, before we even sent in the application, we decided not to do it just because we don't know what the environment's going to be like. And I think Dragon Con actually took that trouble away from us. So it's cool. So it was a plus right there.
There's going to be some movement, I gather, around where a lot of those table spaces are going to be, like the bands and whatnot. I think they are actually going to be in a different location, if I'm not mistaken. And
which might make things easier on Brian Humphreys.
Yeah, well, they mentioned that Brian was going to be back.
When he said he's pretty sure he's in the same area.
Gotcha.
He hasn't been told otherwise yet, so... But they're still
well. Yeah, well, I think they're trying to make sure that there's plenty of room to, you know, if not officially social distance, like at least, you know, spread out so that everybody isn't in as close corners. So that's, you know, and that's another reason why there's not going to be as many folks as guests, because I know that there's the Walk of Fame area is not going to be as populated as it has been in previous years. So, which makes perfect sense. Although there will be like still some stuff happening. Like, there's some new, they announced some new workshops, this year. So that's exciting, including one, I believe by, magicians, right? A magic workshop. So that's mm-hmm. kind of cool. I don't think they've ever done that before, but that's kind of fun. And that's a family friendly one. So, that's always good to hear. Anything else stand out for you, Jen, as far as the announcements that were made there?
Well, they, on the July 8th town hall, they confirmed that day, actually, is what they said, that Epic Photos will be returning to do the prom photos, as I call them, but the professional celebrity mm-hmm. photo ops. And we did get a kind of a tease that confirmed that there will be some after hours programming, specifically during the town hall. They were talking about the animation track, but there will be, you know, some more of the after 10 p.m. 18 and over plus things to attend.
Yeah, it'll still be, I mean, we're not sure exactly because it's going to depend on the hotels, but we're not really sure what the activities are going to be as far as the bars or anything like that goes. So I think that's going to be a call that they're going to have to make, that the hotel's going to make. Now, I do know there's some construction still going on. There has been some renovations. As far as I know, all of the hotels are okay as far as construction goes. I don't think there's anything... but I do know that the escalators by the Peachtree Food Court that go down to the Peachtree Center MARTA station are out of order through September.
So we got to learn a new way to go getting off the
airport. The ones to the right.
There's the other side of the street still.
Yeah, the other side is fine. One side is closed. So
you'll just come out by the other hotel that's right there.
The Peachtree Center MARTA escalator... and elevators next to the Ritz are also still functioning.
Yeah. The north side of that station is easier for the Hyatt, the Hilton, the Marriott, and the south side of that station is easier for the Westin and the Sheraton.
Yeah.
So if you think about it that way, it kind of goes under the whole path of the con, really.
All the years past, I stayed at Westin, and I still just always went out the same way.
Habits. We're creatures of habit. It's fine.
Yeah, I go on autopilot, and I'm like, this seems familiar, going this way. But now I'm staying by the aquarium, so I don't know.
You take an Uber to the aquarium. Yeah. You go to a hotel, and you call an Uber and say, take me to the aquarium, please, and they'll be happy to do it for you.
No, I'm literally staying across the street.
Oh, I know. I'm saying that's what you do, though. If you're coming from MARTA, I would not walk that with suitcases. I would.
Oh, I'm not walking.
I would say call an Uber. That's what I'm saying.
I just didn't know. If there was a MARTA stop near the.
No.
That's as close as you're gonna get.
Peachtree Center is the closest MARTA stop, I believe. So yeah, and it's like a mile and a half hike.
Yeah, but at least from there, it's downhill. Going back.
It is downhill.
Going back.
Coming back. true. When your thighs are throbbing from all weekend.
I can make so many comments for that.
Of course.
From walking. Jesus.
Yeah, I guess we've walked down to that Waffle House by the park, and then walking back to the Westin always sucked. It still wasn't as bad as that Sheraton Hill.
Awesome. I've seen so many people wipe out on that Sheraton Hill.
Mary, am I missing anything else that's really important as far as the news and announcements that have been made over the last month or so?
You guys have really got it covered. You paid as close attention to those town hall meetings as I did. That was awesome.
I mean, there's huge info dumps, right? So, I mean, yes. Yeah, so...
I'm a weirdo who takes
breaks. I'm that weirdo as well.
But you know, I actually prefer the YouTube updates to, you know, when we used to get a the progress report, because you can go back and watch it again. It's the same as having a pamphlet. Just go
I
back
think
and
they're
watch
great.
It.
The fun. Town hall meetings are because people learn so differently. You know, like I would rather personally watch a video, even if it's 20, 30 minutes long, about updates about the convention than read an article. But on the other hand, there are lots of people out there who would rather read a 10-page email, you know, than watch a video. It's just kind of appealing to everyone and how they learn.
Can we get Dragon Con TV to do a video like at 4 a.m. and then pipe that into our rooms at 7 a.m. instead of the late early show? Nah, they're not going to go for that. They're still
drinking. They do that early morning news show, don't they? Yeah,
yes, yeah. That's what I'm saying. Yeah,
the late show.
I forget what it's called. Late I know if I'm late, seeing late, it, late I've show. Done something wrong. Yeah. Which is unfortunate because they do a great job. I just know that's not a time of day I should be doing anything.
No.
I did notice that a couple other things I sort of made notes of during the 27th meeting, because there's been two. June 27th was the first, and then July 8th was the other. So if you want to look them up, those are the dates they were released. So you can look them up that way. And July 22nd, by the way, so a little bit of a little bit after you're hearing this, will be the next town hall there. Also, July 18th will be the first in-person volunteer meeting. So so there'll be some news coming out that week as well, with to tell volunteers as well as track directors, and then of course the next town hall. So the information is just going to keep coming and coming. And August 1st is when they're going to sort of lock down, I think, in a lot of ways their rules and procedures is what I understand. Some things are changing. Some things are coming back. Some things are not. The film festival will not be there this year. So they just didn't have that kind of time to get movies submitted, films submitted, and all of that. There will still be a film track, but the film festival itself will not be done. And then one thing they talked about was that, if you're a gamer, I don't know that there's going to be a 24-hour gaming space that's open to you at all hours. I think
that's more about making sure the area is clean,
right?
And everything
well, that's
else,
yeah,
like disinfecting and such.
Right,
so.
They are going to be
taking, it's understandable.
They are taking cleaning breaks across all the con spaces at periodic times. So there will be times.
Well, there's
where. You won't be able to get into certain rooms. You won't be able to get into the gaming room because they'll be doing a deep clean.
There's also, I think the guy who ran Tokyo Attack no longer has it. And he's the one who, one of the guys who brought in the Japanese arcade games that made up half for the arcade. So I think he was one of the casualties of as he made a post in one of the groups saying he had just wasn't able to keep up with the cost of the upkeep of all the machines and bringing them over and traveling with them.
That's all obviously evolving still. There won't be 24-hour gaming in the America's Mart. We don't have official times for any of that kind of stuff yet, but for those of us like me, who like to go to the game room at 1 a.m. That's unfortunately not something we're going to be able to do this year, but plenty of other occasions to go to the game room as well.
Yeah, the cleaning breaks, you know, across all con spaces. I mean, that's something that I think, you know, probably should have happened anyway. a lot of deep cleaning areas.
I feel seen. I feel very attacked right now. Yeah. What's going on here?
No. Look, the areas. Now, I don't know if that includes the vendor spaces. If those are going to be clean, because those are not 24 hours anyway. So I would imagine just after hours, they'll be cleaned, deep cleaned. So because there are areas in the convention that, you know, probably should need to be cleaned.
Imagine a Midnight Madness sale in the dealer's room?
Come on, Jesus, like, God.
Sunday at 12:01 a.m.
Wow. Yeah, that would be crazy.
That'd be horrifying.
Oh, the smell alone. God.
They announced that Epic Photo, in addition to Brian Humphries is back doing the costume picks, Epic Photos will be returning to do all the celebrity picks. It'll be interesting to see, because they weren't able to say, but how that's going to work in terms of, you know, are you going to be like close to the celebrity? Are you going to be are you going to need a wide shot lens to take pictures of you and the celebrity?
It's going to be a lot of Photoshop. That's what it's going to be.
Very Sesame Street, near, far.
I've seen some groups doing, some companies have used these plexiglass sheets that they put between the celeb and the guest, or congregor. Yeah. And it's so thin that when you see the final photo, you cannot tell that there is a barrier in between them. So they could even like make it look like you're almost touching like elbow to elbow, but you can't see that barrier. So a lot of the companies who are still out there doing cons and celeb photo ops have gotten very
really smart, actually.
Very cool.
They did it for Indiana Jones. Why not for con goers?
I think they've been using that barrier with all the pictures I ever see with people getting their pictures taken with William Shatner, because nobody's ever close to him and it doesn't ever look like they're in the same space. He's not. It always looks like they're awkward. But that's interesting. It'll be curious to see and I would imagine that's not just going to be an Epic Photos thing, but also up to the celebrity too, whatever they're comfortable with, you know? Mm-hmm. So, if you're planning to get those the photos, you might want to find out as much information about that as you can. I would not be surprised if, you know, selfies on the Walk of Fame were not going to be, allowed. There usually there's a no photographic zone anyway.
Yeah, I thought that was a no photo zone anyway.
But certain celebrities, have been sort of like charging for selfies, so you can get selfies there. But I don't know. I would imagine that. I don't know. It depends on whether or not they want to give up that sweet, sweet cash.
Or the celebrity could stay on their side of the table and you just turn around the other side of the table and both look towards the camera. So there were celebrities that took the photos that way at their tables before all this, where they still didn't want to be that close to them. So there are ways to work around every situation.
Yes, absolutely. And I think that's just, in some ways it's just going to be more of the same business as usual there, right? So, it's really going to depend. I mean, I saw people in the chat rooms asking how much are photos going to be, how much are autographs going to be. That is a call. It's been up to the celebrities and their people. So, you won't be able to probably find that out until the day of.
That is something that has always
that's
been
right.
the same.
Yeah.
And it's not been affected.
That's not changed.
And it's not even consistent from con to con. Like, I've looked at, conventions that a certain celebrity is going to be at, like, in Toronto, and have been like, okay, well, that's probably what they're charging. And then at DragonCon, like, oh, no, they're charging this.
Oh, yeah. I think the big one I saw was Billy Dee Williams. Was like, no hand touching, no, you know, autographs. You know, you had to just grab it from his assistant, you know. And everything. It was like $150 for that. It's just like, wow.
Yeah.
Now you just want the photo with the Colt 45 in your hand when you walk.
Exactly.
That's all you need. That's all you need. I like to say photos of the ESA O crew will be free all weekend. So, you know, there you go.
If you can catch us before we get back to our room.
If you can find us. Yeah.
I think that's all the notes I have from the town halls. You know, a lot of information on the aquarium. The aquarium has been through some renovations. So according to the spokesperson, John Walker there, it's pretty spectacular. They've got some new exhibits with sharks and a new baby beluga whale and all of that. So if you're planning to make the Georgia Aquarium part of your Dragon Con weekend, I don't think you'll be disappointed.
Right.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing the changes.
I was going to say, when's the last time you went to the aquarium?
I did when was the last time we were at the convention? 2019. So I went to the party 2017, 16, and 15. So I'd taken 2 years off from it, and then 3 years. So, but once I saw the, you know, VIP passes include a 3-hour open bar, I was like,
well, hello.
You have my attention.
You had me at open bar. There you go.
And we had already, you know, booked our hotel, which is right across from the aquarium. So I was like, you know what? This is the perfect year to go back to the party. We
You're are right there.
Within staggering distance.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Total.
Open bar and then stagger back.
So. I think that's great. That is pretty darn awesome.
But yeah, they said they got a lot of new special effects planned for the party. So I'm excited to see what they have.
I know from the newbies group that they did when they did their virtual town meeting that they do not know the status yet of the tours on Thursday. They've talked, and this is talking to a couple folks from it, they've talked about smaller groups going out and maybe more often to get everybody out because they usually, you know, they go usually every 20 minutes or stuff and... You know, so they don't know yet. And if you haven't been to Dragon Con before or you haven't been in a while, I know most of us haven't because, you know, but do the newbie tour. It is amazing if you get the chance. It's free with your badge and everything. And it takes you around to all the different hotels and, you know, points out some of the key locations and such. It's almost like the walking tour that you could see on YouTube that Darren and I did back in 2018. Ago. I know. God,
everything's changed
forever.
Down there now. And we should really talk about, you know, packing for con. You know, the usual stuff still applies, but I'm going to be bringing some groceries because we don't know what the food court looks like after a year of no one working in their offices for a year.
I know some places are closed. Yep.
So...
I know. My favorite place is closed. I'm bummed.
Which place?
Momo's, the buffet
place. Oh, yeah.
Place.
I figured the buffet was going away because people holding ladles is probably...
Well, Yummy Yummy survived.
Oh, okay. So we have sushi.
The sushi buffet survived. And Aviva is
still
there.
Well, I mean, the sushi is, like, behind glass, so no one's, like, touching everything, so...
I don't know. I've gotten food poisoning 3 times this year, so...
And you went past the second time to go back?
I would try it different years. Yeah. I would like, you know, take a year
I
off.
I have never
like,
had that problem,
better.
But I had a friend who had a firehouse sub that sent him reeling on Friday at con. He was in the bed all day.
No, I have a ton of friends that eat Yummy Yummy all the time, and they're fine. So I obviously just had a bad reaction or something.
Yeah,
right.
But I know it's been confirmed that Trader Vic's will be open because I already have my reservation.
Nice.
And I know there's that new burger place that opened where the Mexican restaurant right on the corner used to be. What is it called? The Whataburger or whatever it is? Or the
Wahlburger.
What's his name?
Okay.
Wahlburger, yeah. Is there now.
That'll be something new.
So that's the. Mm-hmm. So that's a new place. It opened right across
from
Harbaugh.
Bring some cash just in case you need to like get those hotel pop up buffets of the. Hamburgers, hot dogs, bag of chips, and a Coke for $12
oh, God,
or whatever
yes.
it's going to be this year.
Or just remember that there's a Publix short.
Yes, there is a Publix that is really close, but do not walk it. Uber to it.
No, do not.
That's why I said a short drive.
Do not walk that. It is not a good walk.
Yeah, and I know a lot of my friends are talking about doing Uber Eats or, you know, stuff like that for, you know, getting food delivered to their rooms. Plan on a wait for that, even folks.
It's going to be crazy, nuts. And you'll probably have to go down even the lobby to get your food from your driver.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So add elevator time to that.
Exactly, especially if you're at the host hotels.
So the big question, other than when is the app going to be out, is...
Stop it.
Drink!
What about the parade? Mary, what about the parade?
We are still planning on having a parade. There is no official word yet on whether or not we will be having a parade, but the plan currently is to have a parade. So we will see. Obviously, it's a moving target, just like everything else. But we are making preparations to do it.
Gotcha.
I mean, technically, three people constitute a parade.
Yeah, I mean, we're working pretty closely with the city. Like, we do that anyway for the event. It's the largest parade that goes through Atlanta. So obviously, there's a lot that goes into it logistically and working with the city and everything. So we'll just sort of see where the cookie crumbles on that one.
Mm-hmm. Is there a new parade director in place?
I do not know the answer to that.
Okay. That's one thing I don't think I've heard yet, is whether or not they've officially named somebody as the new parade director. Since they lost I can't remember her name now. Bad. But anyway, so I just wondered about that too. So we'll keep our ears pierced on and keep watching to see if there's going to be a parade. I would imagine logistically that, you know, everything that they're doing, last year I thought it was incredible with everything that they had to put together to make the virtual experience as good as it was. And at least, you know, a lot of people were complaining that it wasn't the same and it wasn't exactly, but I mean, they did what they could, and what they could do was pretty remarkable. But this year, deciding to put on an active event and having to coordinate with the CDC and the state and the city of Atlanta and the police department and the five hotels and the other various spaces that are involved, I just takes a level of commitment and coordination that I can't even fathom. It's a project manager's nightmare. And yet, you know, all these people that are doing it, most of which are not getting paid to do so. And I think it's an incredible effort on their part. And whatever we end up getting this year, I'm sure it's going to be, I have every confidence in the world in them that it's going to be spectacular. And it's going to be so good to see everybody again and to come home. To come home to Dragon Con. So I'm glad that we're able to celebrate the 35th anniversary of it in person. That's going to be, I think, really special. In some ways, it might be the most special Dragon Con ever. So I think on that note, I think that's all the news that we have and announcements. Mary, thank you so much for sharing all of the official word.
Absolutely. With us. Actually, I do have an update about your parade director question. We do have a new parade director. Their name is Ann Carter.
Oh, thank you.
So that is all going to be taken care of, just like usual.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you for that. So I guess without further ado, we'll go to meet our new friend, Lisa Bunny, and afterwards we'll close out the show. And now we have joining us a new friend of the show. Lisa Bunny is here. Lisa, welcome.
Hey, Mike. How are you?
I'm all right.
I'm so excited about this.
Oh, well, we are excited to have you. When you reached out, we were very, very pleased. Thank you so much for the good things you said about our podcast. We appreciate that. And I guess we'll start right off the bat. What is your first experience with Dragon Con?
My first con was in 2006, and I had just gone through a really awful breakup. And one of my friends said, literally, pack some weird stuff. I'm taking you to Atlanta. And I was just like, what are you talking about? He was just like, we're going to Dragon Con. And I was just like, So first of all, just for like the sake of backstory, I went to UNCG in Greensboro, North Carolina, and had gone to StellarCon a couple of times. So that was what I had in my head for what was about to happen to me. And then my first memory of being at DragonCon was like we parked and unpacked the car, and we were walking from like the Sheraton up like Baker Street, I think, because we got kind of lost. And just on the side of Baker Street, before you turn back onto Peachtree, there was this whole flock of guys that were dressed like the crazy 88s, like running down the street. And there was literally 88 of them screaming, sure, like arms akimbo with like katanas in the air. And I looked at my friend and I was like, is the rest of this week going to be like this? And he was like, yeah, absolutely. It's totally going to be weird as hell. So buckle up, sister. This is going to be different. But my first con experience was so like intimate and quiet that walking into the Marriott for the first time, I was just like, oh my God, what have I chosen to do with my weekend?
It is amazing. And I would imagine, I mean, man, when I first went, you know, all those many, many moons ago, it was a lot smaller than it is now. So I would imagine, and I was overwhelmed at that time, but I've seen it grow over the course of the years. And I would imagine for those people, you know, really just coming on within the last 5 to 10 years, it really is amazing, like how many people are here and what's going on, everything that's going on.
Yeah, I always try to explain it to people like who've never come, that if you've gone to any other con, it's not going to be like that. And you're about to be with 80,000 of your closest friends. So sure, make sure that you like know how to interact with people, because it's about to happen. Like, this is not for the faint of heart or for the claustrophobic, I guess. I don't know. I've come to rather enjoy the closeness of being around that many people, because if my first year, you know, you could still walk around, like you could still see the floor in the Marriott. So now I get there on Wednesday night and like go up to the Pulse Lounge and look down, and I'm like, nah, it's already, you can't even see the brown carpet anymore. Like, I don't know why we get so upset about it.
Now, did you, that's true. Well, that's a reason why we hide it now. Did you sort of engage in any costumes the first year, or have you done that? Is that your thing?
Yeah, I mean, I do a lot of cosplay, and it's been very different from year to year. But like, honestly, the first year I went, I just packed a bunch of stuff I would have worn to a rave, and like kind of went on about my day. Like, I had like an LED hula hoop and like fuzzy leg warmers and like crazy goth club clothes, and like I didn't have a real costume of any kind. The only thing that kind of got passed off as a costume was I used to have like kind of short black bangs, and I had on like a leopard printed dress, and somebody thought I was Betty Page, and I was just like, I'm okay with that.
sure, that's great. And so did you sort of feel like, oh, well, now I'm going to, did you start planning out costumes coming out?
Well, I lost my mind after that first year. Like,
okay,
it got to a point where I would get back from Dragon Con, and then I would give myself like what I called a break until the end of Christmas. And then like as soon as January 1st hit, I started costuming stuff. Because there was a couple of years in a row when I went down, I was making costumes for myself and I was commissioning them for other people. So of course, like, you know, you start like a million days ahead of time, and like you still are like in the middle of what I call DEF CON 5, long about the 1st of August. My friend Suzanne calls it, like threat level August, which I've just always thought was the most hilarious thing ever.
Yeah, DEF CON August works as well, I think. When you went in 2006, have you been to most of them since, all of them since, or?
Just about every single one of them. I had to miss a con, of course, last year because of COVID. And right. I think it was 2015, because I had moved to DC and I had just started a new job. Mm-hmm. And I just couldn't, getting from DC to Atlanta is kind of tough, especially like right in the middle of a move. So I know I missed that con, sure. But you know, I've been living in Atlanta since 2016 now. There's no reason for me not to go. Like, and I live like 2 blocks from the West End anyway. So now I get to just walk the con, which is amazing.
That is cool. That is, wow. That's great. You don't have to play in the hotel Hunger Games.
No. My days of Katniss costumes are actually kind of retired, because I kind of feel like 40-year-old Katniss is still a little weird. But I do love the fact that I get to save like a month's worth of mortgage and just live in my house and just like walk down there. And it's, that's one of the things I kind of wanted to talk to you guys about today during the podcast, is like people need to be really prepared to see a very different Atlanta than they've seen before. There's still a lot of the exterior of the hotels closed. So kind of be prepared to walk around outside. I've gone down and walked the footprint of the con a la what you guys did a couple of years ago, a couple times now, and it's getting better. I would definitely say be prepared for the shock of what Peachtree Center looks like, because there's a lot of things that have been vacated out of there because of the COVID disaster. But be flexible. Start walking now if you have not started walking, just to get yourself prepared for some of the outdoor activity that you're going to have. And don't forget, Atlanta is hilly. So it's going to be a little bit different outside this year.
Yeah, that little stretch from hotel to hotel is up and down hills. I mean, I don't think there's a straight part anywhere near there.
No. And a lot of the hamster tubes are still closed. I went down there like maybe 2 weeks ago and tried to walk around and like sort of catalog what was going on, because I was actually like working on some stuff for my panel, so I was taking pictures anyway. But John's hallway, I guess I have no other way of calling it, but all those folks who'd like to participate in the cult of John activities need to be kind of prepared. His corner might be closed, so we may have to move our shrine.
Oh no. Wow, that would be sad.
It would be.
That would be very sad.
They did put
sad.
The cutout back up, though.
What's left of
no,
it?
No, it's a brand new one.
Oh, well, that'll change.
I'm wondering if they're going to put him under, like, a Lucite box or something, just to keep him.
Yeah, they're going to have to, yeah, they're going to need a couple of him, I think, extras. As far as your experience going, you mentioned panels, you mentioned costumes, is that... What makes up your DragonCon? What do you like to do? What are some of the your what brings you
well,
back?
Well, I guess for the last 10 or so years, it's just been like make as many costumes as I can and like go down there and like stress out for months and you know, make 6 or 7 different things and like make costumes with my friends, and then we can go costume in groups. And I really didn't start appreciating the quality of the guest lists or the quality of the panel content just until, you know, a couple of years ago. And I don't know, maybe it's a product of middle age, but I'm starting to really get into the panel part of it. Particularly since now I have, I've been granted some of the blessings from the art show track to be able to do a couple of my own, and just seeing DragonCon from the other side of the hallway, more from like the green room side, seeing what goes into it and how much work the track directors do and how thoughtful and how well curated the con is, has really changed my perspective of it being like nerdy gras. And I'm just going down there and like wiling out for 5 days and just getting crazy drunk and hanging out with my friends all night and going to a bunch of raves and like listening to bands. I'm really starting to appreciate the con for the beastly animal that it is, where there's so many different things to do and there's such an accommodation for so many different people and their own tastes. It's just, it's starting to shift for me, and it's been really exciting to see it from the other side.
That's really unique. I appreciate that. Yeah, because you do see a lot of people go for a lot of different reasons. I mean, it's a lot of different kind of conventions all at one space. And it's amazing how much it is able to accommodate so many people, and everybody's con experience is different.
Yeah. I mean, that's like the greatest thing is like, I have friends from very different walks of life, and they come down and they experience their con in a very different way. But we're really lucky that we have a place that we can go and we can stay on the same footprint the entire time. We get to stay there. We get to eat there. We get to walk around there. The con doesn't close. It's not like going to San Diego Comic-Con where you might get to see one panel. Is you got to camp out the entire time and you can't go anywhere. And like, you have to go home at a certain time because everything closes down. I don't think people understand just how fortunate we are that we have like basically like home. I've come to calling DragonCon in the last couple of years, it's like an indoor burn. So if people go to like Burning Man or like Transformers or even like Alchemy, I always tell people it's like a burn with air conditioning now.
And it I think a lot of people, you know, certainly realized last year when we had to go sort of without or go virtual, how much the con really meant and how much, you know, how much we can be affected by it, because it was different, a really different experience for a lot of people.
Yeah. And especially for me living downtown, just walking around on Labor Day weekend and just seeing how empty the city was still and like how closed down everything was. And like, I care. It's one of those weird words that's like on that list. I think it's like Sonder. It's like you're in a place where it should be crowded with people and there's no one there. Like we walked over to the Marriott and like, I just kind of sat down and like, I had this like weird moment of like emotional, like bereftness because like my people weren't there.
Yeah. I can't even imagine what that would have been like. It would have been like sort of watching I Am Legend with Will Smith, and when he's walking down Times Square and there's nobody there, like it's just creepy.
It was like being in a bad Jerry Bruckheimer movie.
Wait, there are good ones? No, just kidding. how do you feel about, you know, going this year?
Nervous but excited, I think. I'm experiencing like this weird time dilation thing where like 2020 was simultaneously the longest year on record and also the shortest. And I really was just trying to like live my best life last year, because like we never knew if like we were gonna get COVID and all be just like violently ill 14 days from like any point. So I just didn't make any costumes, I didn't do anything, and now I've got this like weird con writer's block. So I'm not even really making any costumes this year, because I've got so much other stuff going on. I'm gonna be like, I'm gonna be doing good just to get pants on. So but like,
which again are not required.
No, I mean, the pants are totally optional. Like, we can Donald Duck this, like we're good. But like, one of the things that it's been really conscious in my mind is sort of leaving my pod, because I hung out with basically like, the same people the entirety of like quarantine, and just between like walking the footprint and like starting to socialize again, it's been weird trying to like get myself back into a place where I'm like ready to go out and be in like a huge crowd of people. But I'm looking forward just to that slice of normalcy and like feeling my family again. You know, like a lot of people talk about DragonCon as like going home. And I definitely understand what that really truly means now. Like having a year of no one got to go. It wasn't just me. So there's like no weird selfish implications about it. It's just like this, nobody got to go. And like, we're all just like ready to hug each other and like freak out and scream at the sky and be like, we're a DragonCon. Ah!
Yes, absolutely. Well, and there's still a lot of questions about exactly how it's going to go down, but I'm excited. Do you have any specific plans for DragonCon this year already? As far as, I think you mentioned before we start recording, didn't you mention that you're doing a pre-DragonCon event?
Yeah. So I work at Firemaker Brewing over in West Midtown as my normal day job. And I'm like our cocktail mistress and like bartender. And like I do basically like Jill of all trades work over there. Like pretty much anything our leadership team tells me to do, I just kind of do it. But our owner is really excited to try to help people kind of get back into the swing of things. So we're doing this thing called Hanaliland. Our logo is a dragon, and like we're all kind of nerdy people, and like we, you know, have D&D sets like sitting in the tap room, and like we have a giant 20-sided die that we just hang out with. Like our sales rep wears one as a necklace, and we were all like, let's just have like a pre-DragonCon festival. So we're having bands and a dunk tank, and everybody's welcome to come and cosplay. We're gonna have a bunch of food trucks. I know we're doing like carnival foods. There's gonna be like funnel cake and like grown-up debauchery going on. I know we're gonna dunk our owner in a tank full of beer, which is gonna be really entertaining. But it's an all-day festival, and it's 21 and up. So if you want to come in and try out Wildin' Out again and drink a bunch of limited release beer and limited release cocktails, tickets are already on sale for it. It's over on Chattahoochee Avenue, where a bunch of the other breweries are. So if you've done any of the sort of West Midtown beer crawls around that section of Atlanta, we are right smack dab in the middle of it. And part of the reason why we're so excited about this is we just won number 2 brewery in America. And we were not expecting that, because we closed down 9 days after we opened because of COVID. So for us to survive and to get to this point where we're having this giant party and we get to see all of our DragonCon family that's local and do this giant festival is just kind of a miracle just in and of itself. But we really want people to like lean into the theme of it, like come in, test it out, see how you feel about being in a crowd, drink some beer with your friends, get some of this limited edition beer and like take it home, take it to DragonCon, come in your costumes, test your costume out, like anything that you have that's like a work in progress, you can come in and kind of see what it's like to be in the heat because it's going to be outside. You're going to see like how durable your stuff is. And I know we're going to try to get the cosplay medic folks to come as well. So if anything goes seriously awry, there will probably be somebody there to help you fix it. Either that or just come behind the bar and I gotcha. I will have my glue gun and all the E6000 you could ever possibly want.
So how can we find out more information about that?
The easiest way online to get that is to go to firemakerbeer.com and click on the tab that says events at the top. And that will take you to Hanaliland. Tickets are available on Eventbrite. They start at $10 for general admission and go up to $40 if you want the super extra fancy like package that's got like some swag and some beer and like you get VIP access to everything. And it's August 7th. It starts at noon. No, it starts at 2 o'clock and it goes to 11. But there's definitely going to be a lot of debauchery. Just keep in mind it is a 21 and up event, but you can bring your dog if you want to.
Oh, awesome. Awesome. Well, that's very cool. Well, we will have a link to that in our show notes as well so that people can check it out. Thank you so much for joining us. And we, if we don't see you there, we'll definitely see you at the at Dragon Con itself this year.
All right, guys. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
I hope to everybody Thank can you. Get over to FireMaker and come hang out with us. And welcome back to Atlanta. We missed you.
Great. Thank you.
Bye, guys.
Welcome to Dr. Geek's Laboratory.
Hello, everyone. Dr. Geek here with a shout-out to all the scientists who worked tirelessly to bring a COVID-19 vaccine into reality. Let's face it, creating something of this magnitude is a miracle worthy of Dr. McCoy himself. And now, Dr. Geek needs you to do your part. Remember, each shot is one small step back to normal, one giant leap to putting the pandemic behind us. We can do this. For more information, visit vaccines.gov to find your nearest provider.
There are a lot of great podcasts that review Doctor Who episodes in order. The Earth Station Who podcast is not one of them. Exterminate! Exterminate! Just like the Doctor, we never know where or when we'll end up, but we'll have a lot of fun talking about it. From Classic Who to New Series and Big Finish, join the Earth Station Who crew wherever fine podcasts are found. Earth Station Who is a founding member of the ESO Network.
And so we draw a close to the 7th episode of the 2021 Dragon Con Report. Much thanks to our station crew. Much thanks to Lisa Bunny for joining us. And thank you, Mary, for returning.
Oh, yeah. It's been an absolute blast being back on with you guys. Thank you so much for having me today.
So glad we didn't scare you away.
Not forever. You can't keep me away forever.
Where can people go to find out more about what you guys are doing?
Yeah, absolutely. DragonCon.org. That's got all the info you're going to need on it. We're also doing town hall events on the official DragonCon Facebook page. We talked about that a few times, but those are coming up more or less every 2 weeks. So that's a great source of information as well. But like we said earlier, all of the guidelines as far as safety procedures are going to be available August 1st. You can expect a big update that day. And in the meantime, yep, DragonCon.org and DragonCon Facebook page.
Awesome. Awesome. Thanks, Jen. Thanks. It's good to have you back with us as well.
Always good to be here. Nice to not be writhing in pain like I was last month when I couldn't be here.
So horrible.
Hey, physical therapy is working, so I hope to be back to 100% by con.
I hope so. Yeah, you'll need it. Where can people go to find out more about what you're up to?
I am at the Blurred Nerds. Pretty much on every social media platform, and the Blurred Nerds podcast right here on the ESO Network.
And of course, the pretty much the semi-official
Dragon
Con Report group, right?
So if you're looking, sometimes people have a hard time following the app or the printed version of the schedule. If you are more looking to narrow your focus in on the fun things to do, like dance parties, if they're happening this year, or puppet shows, band performances, group meetups, stuff like that, you can find us on Facebook at the Dragon Con Parties, Meetups, and More group. And here lately, we are also posting a detailed recap of each of the town halls and announcements that the powers that be at Con are making.
Awesome. Awesome. I also have to call out your really cool like lanyard badge holders.
Those were awesome.
Awesome. That's through Odd Birds Boutique. We make custom Marriott carpet zipper pouch lanyards. We make them with an adjustable strap, or we also make it to where you can use your own clip lanyard. It basically has a vinyl window that is a little bit bigger than the Dragon Con badge size. That has a snap button, so it locks it in place so nobody can grab it. There's a hidden zipper pocket for you to keep ID, hotel keys, cash, and a back pocket that fits the new size iPhone.
Wow. Okay.
So, and it can be.
Where can I get one of those?
I want one of those now.
You can go to Odd Birds Boutique, or you can actually, I made a post about it in the Dragon Con Parties group. And in the Lovers and Scavengers group as well. So basically it's just, you message me and I take care of the sale for you.
We got to figure out how to...
What is it one more time?
Go to the Dragon Con Parties group and scroll down for Jen Sleisner's post. And you'll see the picture of the badges and you can just send me a message.
And there'll be a link in the show notes as well. Okay. So you can go right there. And
we're going to be very, very busy, my dear.
I think we have 12 left for this season and then we're done. So, yeah. Gotcha.
For next season, next year, we got to work on getting some made with the Dragon Con Report logo.
Okay, yeah. I have a new embroidery machine I've been learning, so that's a distinct possibility.
Let's try to get that done. That'd be cool. Thank you, as always, Darren, for joining us as well.
Oh, you're welcome, sir. Anytime I can come along and add a little sparkle to your day.
And sparkle you have, especially last month. I got to tell you, the response to our Earth Station 1 episodes, our two episodes on Angels of America was really well received. So thank you again for headlining that for us.
You are welcome, sir.
Where else can people find you?
Legion of Substitute Podcasters.com, where I talk all about DC Comics, Supergroup Legion of Superheroes and all the comic-y goodness, and of course here on the Dragon Con Report.
And of course, thank you, Director Faber, for which none of this would be possible without your assistance and basically all that you do, man.
Hey, dude, you know, I just love, you know, sitting around and clicking record and hearing strange ladies' voices. It's awesome.
Anything on any of your shows that you want to promote?
Well, you know, I have a thing called the ESO Network. It's, you know, just a couple shows here and there, talking about all things geek, and, you know, got some great stuff coming up. We on Earth Station 1 this last week, we just did our report on, of course, Black Widow. And next week, probably by the time this goes live, we'll be talking about Loki. That should be a ton of fun.
I think we'll be heavily represented at Dragon Con this year, I imagine, in costume form.
Oh, if I want to count how many Lokis we see.
This may be the first year that Deadpools are outnumbered.
It might be.
Calling it now. This may be.
Or how many Deadpool Lokis are we going to see?
Yeah, you know? Deadpool Lokis, probably a thing, yeah.
And Harley Lokis. And...
Mary Lou Loki. She'll be around.
Yeah. I think there's just going to be a lot of alligators, too.
Alligators?
Yeah.
And I'm still expecting a horde of Agathas and Wandas in the 1950 dresses.
Oh, yeah. Don't forget about WandaVision.
Oh, of course. I want to see them do the black and white. It should be really cool.
I want to see a really cool Captain America Sam Wilson costume this year.
Oh, I am sure we're going to see
that. That's what I really want to see.
Yeah, I'm sure we will. If not, more than one.
Yeah, totally.
We try to cover all we can with these episodes, but to keep up with the latest news, as Mary pointed out, please check out the official Dragon Con website and all their social media outlets as well, including their Facebook group, Instagram, Twitter account, Discord. Mary, how's that TikTok account coming with Dragon Con? Have they got that going on yet?
We absolutely should if we don't. That's a great idea.
I know that they reserved an account. I just don't think it's been used yet. So,
All right. I'll have to look into that. What encouragement I can give from Dragon Con TikTok.
All the fan tracks are active on Facebook and social media as well. So check them out. We here on our show are proud members of the ESO Network. We have a Tee Public store filled with all kinds of cool designs, including a very cool one for the Dragon Con Report podcast. There's a link for that at the top of the ESO Network page. We also have a Patreon page, and thank you, patrons, for all your support. Be sure to check out past episodes at DragonConReport.com. We can also be found on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And however you're listening to us, please rate us and leave us a review. If you would like to leave us direct feedback or comment on the show, please feel free to contact us at feedback@DragonConReport.com. We appreciate you hanging out with us, and thanks for listening. I'm your host, Mike Gordon, and it has been my pleasure. Take care, stay safe, get vaccinated,
And we hope to see you at the con very, very soon.
Bye.
Peace. And we're done.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, I'm so excited. I can't wait to be back. Ah!
This has been a broadcast of the ESO Network. Be part of the crew and help support our shows by donating to our ESO Patreon or by shopping at the TeePublic store, which can all be found at www.esonetwork.com. The ESO Network, your station for all things geek.